Hello, I'm Martin Looker from Silicon Labs. In this video in the Simplicity Studio series, I'll be making use of an example application to explore Simplicity Studio's development features. Now we've seen the launcher and an example application in use, let's look at some of the time-saving features of Simplicity Studio when it comes to developing your application. I'll begin by creating the Bluetooth SoC empty example application. I've filtered the example applications by searching for empty, and the one that I'm looking for is the Bluetooth system on chip empty example here. So if I click the create button, that will begin the process of creating the project file and source code files for this particular application. Once your project has been created, Simplicity Studio will switch to the Simplicity IDE perspective, and you can swap between perspectives using the tabs in the upper right-hand corner. The new project and its files will appear in the Project Explorer on the left-hand side of the window. Some of the key files for the project will be automatically opened in the main part of the window. The README file contains information to get you started using the example. For this empty project, we have some links to the reference material you may need to continue development. Then there is some guidance on how a Bluetooth application is constructed and how to use EFR Connect to communicate with it. Finally, there are some troubleshooting tips, including the required bootloaders to use with the example, and you'll find the bootloader projects back in the launcher with the other example applications. The GATT configuration or database file defines the Bluetooth profiles and services offered by the application, and you can use the GUI to edit them. You can add standard Bluetooth features defined by the Bluetooth SIG using this button. And then you can select profiles, services, characteristics, or descriptors to add into your database. If the Bluetooth SIG has not defined the functionality for your application, you can add custom elements using this button. If you need to reopen this file, you can find it in the Project Explorer under your project within the config btconf folder. The .slcp file provides project configuration and quick links to other files and tools. The Overview tab provides information on the target board and the SDK in use, together with some information about the project. And on the right, you'll find some quick links to the most used files and tools, including the Bluetooth GATT configurator we just looked at. If you need to reopen this file, you'll find it directly under the project folder in the Project Explorer. Under the Configuration Tools tab, you can also access the Bluetooth GATT configurator, along with the pin tool for setting up the pins on your hardware chip and the memory editor. The Software Components tab is where you can really accelerate your code development. There are many modules in here that can be added into your application with just a few clicks. And where these affect pins on the board, it will automatically configure the pins on the chip that you're using. And you'll find drivers in here for the sensors that are built into some of our boards, like the development kit that we've been using today. Let's take a quick look at how to add support for the RGB LED that's on the XG24 dev kit. If I search for RGB in the components, I can find the simple RGB PWM LED here. You'll get a bit of a description and some dependencies if there are any. To bring this code into our application, we can simply click the install button. This will then ask us to create a component instance, and in most cases, it will recommend a particular instance name. These recommended instances will also configure the pins that control this device. So now the component's been added, initialization code will automatically be invoked within the application. And the pins have also been configured for this particular device as well. If you want to create more than one instance of a software component, you can do so by clicking the Add New Instances button. You can also go in and check and alter the configuration of the software component. So in here, you can see the timer modules that are used to drive this, and the pins that are associated with the various color channels for the RGB LED. If we take a look at the configuration tools and open up the pin tool, you can see that these pins here have been assigned to the RGB LED instance for the simple RGB PWM LED driver that is now part of our application. To make use of the RGB LED, now we have the driver in place, all you need to do is add the relevant API calls into your application. If for some reason you don't want to make use of the software components and drivers, you can also use this pin tool to graphically set up the peripherals that are associated with each pin on the device that you're using. Before we wrap up this video, let's take a quick look at the main source code file that you'll need to edit to create Bluetooth applications, which is the app.c file. In here, you'll find a structure that forms the basis of all Silicon Labs Bluetooth applications. The app init function is called once during startup and will allow you to perform initialization if you need to for your application. The app process action function is called repeatedly, though you shouldn't place any blocking functions in here, and you should allow it to return as quickly as possible to allow the Bluetooth stack to perform its own operations. Next, we have the SLBT on event function. This function is the main event handler for Bluetooth applications, and in here you'll find handlers for various different events that you can use to create your Bluetooth application. Not all the event handlers are present in this skeleton code. You may need to add some depending on the needs of your application. For further information on constructing Bluetooth applications, you can return to the launcher and filter to Bluetooth technology type. And in here, you'll find reference guides for the Bluetooth APIs. When you're ready to compile your application, select the top level of the project in the Project Explorer and use the build button that has a hammer icon on it. As the build takes place, you'll see output in the console panel, and any problems, errors, or warnings will be displayed in the problems panel. Once the application is compiled, you'll find various binary formats in the binaries folder under your project. The easiest one to work with is the .s37 file. If you right-click it and choose Flash to Device, you'll open the Flash Programmer. To program this into a board that's already got a bootloader in it, because this is a Bluetooth application, you can simply click the Program button. If your board doesn't have a bootloader in it, you'll first need to erase the whole board, enter the Flash Programmer with the bootloader application and program it, and then follow it up with the actual application binary. If you already have a bootloader in place, you don't need to keep reprogramming it each time you update the application. If you want to debug your project rather than simply running it, you can use the debug button here to begin the debug process. This will transfer the file and take you into the debugger. So we can see here, this is broken in the main function, which is included in main.c. And this is where the application functions are called. So the SL system init that you can see here is the initialization of all the various software components, including the Bluetooth stack that form this application. Then we can see the call to the app init function that we talked about a short while ago. And then we enter the main loop, where the main processing for the stack and any components that you have installed will take place within this function. And finally, you'll see the app process action function that gets recalled repeatedly from this main loop. And in the debugger, you can set breakpoints as usual, a run and step into and out of functions. So this is how you get into the debugger for your application. If you've completed this Simplicity Studio series, you should now be in a position to begin developing your own applications. If you need further help, take a look for other videos. Our Quick Look videos give a brief demonstration of a particular example or technology. The Quick Start videos, like the one you're watching, will get you started installing or working with a particular technology. And finally, the longer DevLab videos will walk you through the creation of a project step by step. Thanks for watching.